Simon & Schuster Audio presents Machiavelli for Women. Defend Your Worth, Grow Your Ambition, and Win the Workplace. By Stacey Vanek Smith. Read by the author.
For my beautiful mother, my grandmothers, and all the women who came before. Note on translations. In studying the prints, I mainly used two translations. The first was the Dover Thrift Editions version, translated by N.H. Thompson. I loved this translation for the beauty of its language. I also relied heavily on the Millennium Publications edition, translated by W.K. Marriott. I valued the clarity of this translation. Introduction. I first read The Prince in college. I was taking a political philosophy class, and we were reading all the greatest hits. Plato, Hobbes, Marx, Machiavelli. I hated The Prince. How to seize power, how to hold on to power, should you build a fortress, should you slaughter the locals when you conquer new territory? Apparently, it largely depends on whether you enjoy the same foods. It was also brutish and bloody and cynical and depressing. I preferred Cicero and Rousseau. They wrote such beautiful, soaring treatises on society and man's place in it. Man, it was always man, was noble, godlike, and so full of beauty, grace, and goodness that if you just set him free to explore his own nature, let him do him, the world would blossom into a glittering, shining place of learning, leisure, art, and brotherhood. Machiavelli, on the other hand, describes humans as thankless, fickle, false, and greedy, a sorry breed. He condones, at different moments in The Prince, lying, bragging, the killing of children, and pretending to be friends with someone and then stabbing them in the back. At one point in the book, he does a truly chilling cost-benefit analysis of whether to exterminate the local population once you've taken control of a new land. To his credit, he comes out against it, but just barely. The Prince was the opposite of inspiring or uplifting. It was cynical, depressing, and did absolutely nothing for my 18-year-old soul. Fast forward 25 years. I've worked in journalism organizations all over the country, starting at the Idaho Statesman as a copy editor, moving on to Idaho Weddings and Boise Magazine, then to journalism school in New York. From there, I went to the public radio show Marketplace. Then, a decade later, to NPR's Planet Money podcast. A few years ago, I helped NPR launch Planet Money's daily The Indicator podcast and serve as host of the show. I've worked through the housing crisis, the Great Recession and Recovery, the podcast bubble, and the coronavirus pandemic and recession. I have seen countless reshufflings, promotions, layoffs, demotions, firings, furloughs, Me Too scandals, backstabbings, and politicking. Watching it all play out, I have never once found myself thinking about Cicero or Rousseau. But I have found myself thinking about Machiavelli a lot. I think that cynical, brutish Italian was onto something. Granted, women taking advice from Machiavelli might seem strange. Like, do we really need another old white guy mansplaining power to us? Hey, ladies, here is how you can finally be the cold-hearted, murderous tyrant you always dreamed you could be. I mean, no. But I would argue murderous tyranny is not what Machiavelli is all about. Machiavelli was an incredibly clear-eyed, original thinker who might just be history's first true champion of real talk. For that reason, there could be no better guide for women in the workplace. If there's something that is in short supply amid all the outrage and girl power rhetoric, it is data, research, and real solutions. Machiavelli was a big believer in those things. And he might have been the greatest of all time at figuring out what obstacles stood in the way of people getting into leadership positions and how they could overcome those obstacles. In the 500 years since Machiavelli wrote The Prince, a lot of things have changed. We have electricity, the combustion engine, airplanes, computers, and antibiotics. We've explored the outer reaches of our solar system, the surface of Mars, the ocean floor, and we've even split the atom. People, though, haven't changed one bit. All the petty jealousies, treachery, power-mongering, and aggression people practiced in the 1500s are alive and well in the modern workplace. In fact, more than anyone else, Machiavelli has helped explain some of the contradictions around women in the workplace that have always bothered me. Namely, that some of the progress is so exciting, inspiring, and undeniably amazing. But in other areas, women seem stuck. Consider this. In school, women get better grades than men in all subjects, including math and science. Women graduate from high school and attend college in higher numbers than men. There are more women than men in medical school and law school. Women are running for office and getting elected in unprecedented numbers. Nearly 40% of businesses in the United States are now started by women. And also, women are having a moment. The cultural shift brought about by the Me Too, Time's Up, Black Lives Matter, and other social and political movements are changing workplace cultures everywhere, including at NPR, where the head of the newsroom left his job in 2017 following allegations of sexual harassment. All of this is great, real and substantial progress, hard won by generations of pioneering women. Except in other ways, things seem to be distressingly backward. 80% of CEOs are men. For Fortune 500 companies, it's more than 90%. Corporate boards are more than 80% male. Women make about 80 cents for every dollar a man makes. Two-thirds of federal judges are male. 75% of elected representatives are men. Women start 40% of the businesses in the country, but 98% of venture capital goes to men. What this litany of depressing statistics tells us is that although women are arriving in the workplace and breaking into new fields at an unprecedented rate, once they get there, they're not rising to the highest levels of power. They are not leading innovation. They are not making the big decisions. They are not making our laws or moving our markets or deciding our court cases or running our companies. Women are in the workplace, but they are not reaching Machiavelli's princely realms. Why? Everybody has their theories. Popular explanations include women shy away from leadership positions. Women want more flexibility with their time, so they avoid the most demanding jobs. Women are more nurturing and collaborative, i.e., they lack the killer instinct you need in a leader or decision maker. Women gravitate toward less lucrative fields. All of these explanations have seeds of truth in them. But I believe the real reason for the frustratingly slow progress of women in the workplace is something Machiavelli summed up quite well more than 500 years ago. Let it be noted that there is no more delicate matter to take in hand, nor more dangerous to conduct, nor more doubtful in its success than to set up as a leader in the introduction of changes. For he who innovates will have for his enemies all those who are well off under the existing order of things, and only lukewarm supporters in those who might be better off under the new. This lukewarm temper arises partly from the fear of adversaries who have the laws on their side, and partly from the incredulity of mankind, who will never admit the merit of anything new until they have seen it proved by the event. If I were to translate Machiavelli's sentiments into modern English, I would say, changing a system is really hard and you will probably fail. The old guard will freak out because they have so much to lose, and the people who would benefit from the change will waffle because they're scared and skeptical of how much they would really benefit, even if you did manage to pull off this crazy hat trick. Today, Niccolò Machiavelli is best known as a ruthless powermonger, devoid of ethics and compassion. The phrase most often associated with him, the ends justify the means, which Machiavelli never actually wrote but probably would have heartily agreed with, has turned him into an apologist for sociopaths, tyrants, and megalomaniacs the world over. Psychologists have even developed a category of personality disorder called Machiavellianism, part of the dreaded dark triad, along with narcissism and psychopathy, characterized by extreme duplicity, amorality, and manipulation. Conscienceless con men. That is what Machiavelli's name has come to stand for. I think this is a gross misunderstanding of both the man and his work. The prince does not condone random cruelty or tyranny or violence. It is a remarkably sober look at how people take power and how they can best hold on to it and grow it. In fact, I believe The Prince was not a book written out of cynicism or narcissism or power lust. I believe it was a book written out of love. Not love of people, we are basically the worst after all, but love of a city. Machiavelli loved Florence. He really loved Florence. He wasn't big on warm, fuzzy type feelings, but he actually wrote in a letter to a friend, "I love my native city more than my own soul." And Machiavelli wrote the prince to try to save his city. Machiavelli came of age during the Italian Renaissance. It was a time of amazing progress in technology, art, philosophy, and science. Leonardo da Vinci was inventing flying machines, Michelangelo was sketching out the Sistine Chapel, Botticelli was serving up curvy pink ladies on the half shell. Italy was a cultural and commercial center of the Western world. It was also a veritable bloodbath. Italy was divided into city-states that were controlled by a motley crew of powerful families, the Catholic Church, and various foreign powers. The Italian families.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.